member of this congregation. God's abiding grace will be sufficient for us in Jesus' name. Let us pray. O Lord our God, let your word be unto our heart a two-edged sword that we put to death every form of flesh in our lives, such that we shall not be the same again. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The theme for today's message is living under the new covenant. Living under the new covenant. Beloved, before we can live under the new covenant, or old covenant, whichever one we think, we need to know first what is covenant. We need to know which one is new covenant, which one is old covenant, and why did we have to change from old covenant to new covenant. Covenant is a pledge or agreement or a contract or a compact made between two parties. In the case of biblical covenant, it is covenant between God and the Israelites, who represent human. Covenant between God and human. The Bible tells us in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 15, it says, and for this cause, he is the mediator of the new testament, or the new covenant, that by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first covenant, they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. If we look at that, eternal inheritance is an important aspect of the new covenant. Verse 16 of Hebrews 19 says, for where the testament is, there must also of necessity be the death of the testator. That is, if you have covenant, it's just like writing a will. And it's telling us that at least the owner of the will must die first before we try to start talking about the will. Verse 17 says, for a testament is of force after men are dead. Otherwise, it is of no strength at all while the testator is alive. That is giving us a summary, the comparison between the old covenant, which God operated with the Israelites, and the new covenant. With the old covenant, they were using goats, bulls, blood of all these animals for remission of sins. There was nothing like forgiveness at that time. But with the new covenant, it was the blood of Jesus Christ that was used. And you know, as it was put before, that blood of bull, blood of goats cannot lead us to eternal kingdom. They themselves don't know eternal kingdom. They are not looking forward to it. That is why in the new covenant, which was the maximum that God would give unto us, it was Jesus Christ, his son, that died so that our sins can be taken away. There are so many ways we can compare these two covenants. The first one, we do not have direct access to God. You cannot come to God by yourself. Nowadays, people can come to the altar, kneel down, talk to God, and God will answer. At that time, there were barriers in between them. There were Holy of Holies. But now, with the new covenant, you have free access to God. The other one is that there is eternal inheritance. There is promise of eternal kingdom with the new covenant. It wasn't there in the old covenant. But brethren, why not change this old covenant? Was it because of the failure of the covenant? We are told it wasn't so. It wasn't because of the problem. The problem was not with the covenant. The problem was with people. Because people were unfaithful. People were unfaithful. They were not able to deliver their own aspects of the covenant to God. We all know many of them were idolatry, worshipping other gods, doing all sorts of things which God did not expect as part of that covenant at that time. He got to a point that God was annoyed to the extent that he used water flood to flood away the surface of the earth. But God also repented on that and said he would not do that again. He knew that the heart of man, as it was like stone. And he decided he would change the heart of man to the heart of flesh. Now, why are we shaking under the new covenant? Are we living under the new covenant or old one? Are we sure we are living under the new covenant? Because the old one has changed. All those good things that God planned for the earth when he introduced the new covenant was that we would believe in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ came, died for our sins, we will follow him. But what do we have? Many people are not doing so, even now. And this is why it's even doubtful whether we are following the new covenant or not. Are we living under the new covenant? Am I living under the new covenant? Are you living under the new covenant? In actual fact, some of us, or even one of us, are living under the old covenant. Some people still go to run to churches where they will fast for them, where they will call libation, where they will sacrifice, where the pastor will say, "Come, bring this, bring that, bring that, bring that," and they will be living. Secondly, some of our sins that prevail during the old covenant are still being committed today. Why do we have sacrificing human beings even at the time when the election was coming? Why do we have rampart even in the house of God lying on you? Why do we have adultery, fornication, etc., all prevailing in our society? In fact, kidnapping had been settling into these streets. There wasn't any kidnapping in the Old Testament. These things will have been taken away with the new covenant, which took all those terrible sins of the past away. All those sins for which Jesus Christ came to the world, died and carried away all unrighteousness, we are still having them with us. Beloved, which covenant are you living in? It may be difficult to tell, but I will give us some tips which will guide us. One is that you still live in fear, that you do not know where you go after this world. That is, you are not sure of God's eternal kingdom. You are not sure your name is written in the book of life. Whereas, in John Gospel chapter 14, verses 1 to 6, in verse 1 particularly, Jesus Christ said, let not your heart be troubled. Do not be afraid. Do not fear. And what are you supposed to do? Ye believe in God, believe also in me. Brethren, you are still having difficulty believing in God. If so, then do not belong to the new covenant. Number two, that John 14, you have to say, in my Father's house have many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. Have you made your reservation in that new mansion? True godliness, true godly living. You have your name labeled on any of the mansions already. Jesus said, Father, I'm going and prepare a place. I go and prepare a place for us. Promised us to come again and to take us to himself. Do you even believe in the second coming of Jesus Christ? Do you believe that is drawing nearer and nearer? I was happy to hear during the Bible study end time. Do you believe end times are here almost already? Are you investing in that heavenly kingdom? Are you laying your treasures here on earth? Where moth and rust don't corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. Rather than in heaven, Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 to 20 admonished us. Lay your treasures in heaven, where all this will not happen. Four. Are you still committing all sins of the old covenant for which there were heavy curses? For example, there are so many sins listed in Deuteronomy chapter 28. Many of them are followed by a serious curse, very heavy curse. Are we still committing those sins, or we have given them up? Number five, beloved, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Are you on the right way to the Father? You know the way to the Father. You know that it is only by believing in Jesus, that he died for the sake of us. Therefore, what can we do to be sure that we live under the new covenant? What can we do to inherit the kingdom of God? We are. One is in John 3:16 is the covenant. It's a covenant by itself. It reminds us that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. That was God's part of the covenant. Has he done it or has he done it? He has done it. That whosoever believes in him, that is not our own part of the covenant. Whosoever believes in him shall not die, but have eternal life. I pray, by the special grace of God, we will all be inheritors of eternal life.
Amen.
So the first thing is that you must believe that Jesus Christ came for you and died for you. Two, you must shun the works of the flesh, which are specified in Galatians chapter 5, from verses 19 to 21. Shun the works of the flesh, which are manifest: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and such like. Even greed. Because that is the one that is killing our country fast. Greed by people that are put into authority. Greed, they are no longer faithful to their creed. They do not keep the treasury as they were expected to. What did the Bible tell us will happen? When we do this, we cannot inherit. That will not be our portion in Jesus. Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 to 23. He says, you must be led of the Spirit. You must be led of the Spirit. And to be led of the Spirit, you must fill yourself with the fruit of the Spirit. And the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, meekness, temperance, and faith. People don't like gentleness any longer nowadays because it portrays you as if you cannot fight, as if you cannot do it. So many things they detest about people who are gentle. But that is the commandment of God. That is the law of God. If all of us were gentle, this country would not have been in any disaster. And finally, brethren, lay your treasures in heaven. Lay your treasures in heaven. Are you laying your treasures here or now? Or are laying them in heaven? You fulfill your obligations to your church, to your God, and to your future. The new covenant is based on John chapter 3, verse 16. God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but shall have eternal life. Do you believe in him? Do I believe in him? The Lord help us. Let us pray. Tell God you are ready, you are prepared, you want to claim your inheritance of eternal kingdom, and you do not want any obstacle to be on your way. Tell God you are prepared, and you trust in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
Heavenly and ever gracious Father, thank you for sending us your Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from perishing. Grant us the heart to believe in him and the grace